And welcome back to another episode of What is Andreas Talking About When He's Putting Things on the Internet? Yes, that's right. He's written another blog post about more potentially controversial topics. And I am here to ask more questions and get some answers. Andreas, how are you doing today? And tell us about the blog post.
I am doing very well. I wrote a blog post. We'll link it in the description. Called CSS Become Too Powerful. And I'm basically making the case that for at least a lot of CSS, and I would actually argue almost all the CSS you write, the biggest limitation of CSS is no longer language features, but actually the way we write it. Like the fact that we are typing it into text files, using selectors to hook up to classes and separate files, etc. That's actually becoming the biggest bottleneck and the biggest sort of thing, I think, that is holding CSS back these days.
Okay, so you start the article with these words. Modern CSS is amazing. It empowers us to build incredible experiences on the web, but as CSS becomes more powerful, we are beginning to see a new weak point. And according to you, Andreas, our weak point is our brains. In this post, you are basically saying, brain bad, we will never CSS good. Andreas, why do you hate the human brain?
I don't know that I said it exactly like that, but the reader can obviously read, or the viewer can read, view for themselves and read the article and see. But yeah, I think for some of the new, more powerful CSS features, it's getting harder and harder to sort of visualize mentally what the text you're writing is going to be on the screen, or vice versa, what you want on screen, how that translates into text. And the first case I make is the new OKLCH color space.
Let's talk about that. So in the post, you mentioned that in the recent 2025 State of CSS survey, only 12% of participants reported that they've tried any of the new level 4 wide gamut color spaces and had a positive experience. So I'm one of those devs. I've never actually tried using one of the new color spaces. I reach for hex codes. I always have done. And honestly, when I'm building prototypes and example projects, I use CSS color keywords. So what am I missing out on?
Oh, you're missing out on quite a lot, actually. So first of all, and I think probably the biggest thing is that modern monitors are pretty good. And they can display a lot more colors than you can represent in hex or in the what's called RGB color space. And RGB is this idea of like you basically try to mix colors together, say how much red, how much blue, how much green do I want in this color, right? And when you give the right amount of each of those, you end up with a result color. And like we can sort of match in our brains. Like if you mix, you know, blue and red, you get purple.
Purple.
Roughly, right? But that's pretty much where it goes. Like when you start to go like 30% blue and 100% like, you kind of can't visualize it anyway. And the mixing those three colors is just not the most intuitive or smartest way to think about color. It actually makes a lot more sense what we normally then move to HSL, which is a different way of defining colors, where you're saying, like on the big color wheel, what angle on that, what hue do you want to have? And then after that, you get how saturated should the color be and then how light should the color be. And we actually, generally, most color pickers moved to that quite a long time ago. But when we're writing CSS, we still prefer RGB or hex just because it's normal, even though there are actually better options out. Now, for OKLCH, that's even more interesting because that can represent more colors than RGB can. So you can actually, like, you have access to new and more vivid colors that you can display on your website. And if user's monitor doesn't support them, it'll just kind of fall back to the nearest tone. So it still looks great. But if we're not switching color spaces and how we represent this, we're not getting access to all the user's browser and the monitor can actually do.
Why do you think people who've tried the new color spaces haven't had a positive experience?
So I think a part of it is that like I said, that it's more intuitive for HSL, and that's right, but that doesn't mean it's actually that intuitive. You still have to say things like, what is the angle on the color wheel? And not everybody has a color wheel. They can, like, they, everybody knows roughly what it looks like, but I don't know anybody knows what, like, 45 degrees, what hue that will look like. So it's still not intuitive to go from text to a color to a text. Like, that's just not something our brains are really built for. So adding in a color picker makes that way more usable, right?
So obviously we can't visualize the color wheel, and obviously it's difficult for our brains to also visualize color gradients, which is an interesting point, because I don't think I've ever just written a gradient in CSS from scratch. I've either like copied and pasted an existing gradient and played around it until I'm happy, or as you mentioned in the blog post, I've used a visual gradient editor to create the CSS text that I need. But maybe there's a better way to write gradients in text that we have yet to discover that our brains can visualize more easily. What do you think? Maybe we just need to make text easier to work with. I don't know. I'm just trying to put these ideas out there.
Maybe. I don't think so, though. I think at a fundamental level, it applies to quite a, I think we use color and gradients as good examples. Like, I can never remember the syntax for gradients because I don't write them that often. Because as you say, dialing in the right gradient is something you either do in text where you make 1,000 micro adjustment, or you use a gradient generator. There's 1,000 of them online. I think everybody uses them when you want to make a gradient, right? So it's kind of become the normal to use a visual tool for that. And then you copy in the CSS, right? So I don't think text is the right format for that. I think it's just not meant for, like, it's just not very good for building visual things, because it's hard to visualize things based on their essentially instructions. At Nordcraft, we don't just use color pickers and gradient editors. We use visual editing for everything, because you just get that instant feedback. You can see the changes as you make them. So any time where you don't ahead of time know that this thing has to be exactly 450 pixels wide, or how big something should be, like any time where there's some uncertainty and you need to see it to dial it in, having a visual tool like that just makes everything so much easier. Right?
So yeah, moving on, talking about using visual tools for everything. So I've had the same experience with CSS keyframe animations as gradients, where it's easy to write like a simple from and to animation, from, you know, left 100% to right 100% kind of thing. That's not even the right way to do it. But you see, but as soon as you start adding custom keyframes, it quickly gets more complicated. Now, I was thinking we could, in theory, as web developers, spend the time to learn how to create things like spring and bounce physics and Bezier curves manually. It's a bit like the color wheel, really. We could study the inner workings of how it all works and then become this superhuman with this superpower of writing Bezier curves from scratch. But let's be honest, is that a real productive use of our time? I just want to build websites, not study for a physics degree.
I don't even think that's possible. Like, I don't even think that's the thing. Like, while building Nordcraft, we actually had surprisingly often have to work with Bezier curves and like how to generate them. And like the idea that you take four numbers, I give you four numbers, and then you in your mind first generate that curve, visualize the curve that those four numbers are going to do as a produce as a Bezier curve. And then after that, not just visual the shape of the curve, but you're able to, in your mind, predict how an animation is going to follow that timing function, how it's going to slow up and slow down, and whether that's going to give the right feel. I think we are so far outside of what human brains are capable of now that it's just not realistic. And again, it's one of those things where we never do that, right? Like, we never use that. If you're going to use a custom Bezier curve for timing function in CSS, odds are you use the tool to generate it, right? Because it's terrible to do any other way. There's a really good called Easing Wizard standalone tool you can use for that. And we have that built into Nordcraft as well, right? Because there's just so much of this that's just, if you don't have a tool to help you generate these things, you're almost certainly not going to do it. That most people just use the ease in and out keywords, right?
And these tools have existed for a number of years, haven't they? Probably, you know, 15, 20 years since these features of CSS were released. And as soon as something became a little bit too hard to parse in the brain, people started to try and make it easier with visual tooling. And it's very interesting that the norm right now is to use subsidiary tools as well as your IDE, rather than bring everything together like we're trying to do in Nordcraft. And talking of the CSS new features and stuff, you mentioned in the post about keeping up with the CSS working group to learn about new CSS features. Now, I thought I would try this. I tried this once. I subscribed to all the notifications on GitHub to learn about what was going on and what was being released. I set up email filters and everything. But it was so overwhelming. They're doing so much all the time. They're discussing so much all the time. They've got these new proposals that are coming left, right, and center. Some of them go further. Some of them just disappear. There's a lot of people doing a lot. And I had to stop. But like, I honestly feel I know so little about CSS features because I'm not sure where to look because there's so much noise on the internet right now. And I'm sure there are many people feel the same. You mentioned in the post that visual editors and IDEs are a great way for web developers to discover these new CSS features without having to subscribe to the CSS working group notifications, especially when paired with the built-in documentation. One of the things I mentioned on the internet this week was that in Nordcraft, we now have a list of HTML attributes to choose from on every new HTML element, which is so good to discover what's possible. But Andreas, I wanna ask you a controversial question. You said IDEs are great for this, which they are, and visual editors, but why are you talking about IDEs when you want people to use Nordcraft, which is a visual editor?
Well, I don't think the difference is all that strong, to be honest. I think we just went a step further and saying, actually, we can build more tools into an IDE to the point where we don't really directly look at the code very much anymore, right? But I do think we're getting to that point where these languages are growing at such a rate that it's actually difficult to keep up. And at the same time, it's so much good stuff. Like CSS has improved so much in the last couple of years, right? I'm constantly on NDN trying to figure out like what are actually the, how many different type of display properties are there now, right? Because there's almost certainly 50 to 100% more than I think there am. Mm-hmm. There is, right? And can I use them? And what is the support for all these? Are these safe to use, etc.? And it becomes a non-insignificant part of my time doing that when mm-hmm. working on new things, exploring, right? So again, having tools that brings that into the workflow is extremely helpful.
I'm going to wrap up with my final question. Your final words in the post center around how CSS is becoming more powerful every day and has in many cases outgrown the text editor. And that's a good thing and worth celebrating. And with that said, what is your final message that you want everyone to go away from this video with? What is the bottom line around this discussion?
I think a lot of people, especially developers, still have like an idea that that the text editor is somehow an important part of this ritual, or like of writing CSS. We meet a lot of people that are very skeptical of the of not writing everything by hand. And I think there are some real limitations to that approach. Like, I think that will end up holding you back in a lot of ways. And while I can respect it to some degree, I do think it's very limiting. Again, things like gradients is just not something it's worth spending time writing in hand. It makes more sense to grade it. Timing functions. There's so many cool things you can do with things like clip path today. But I think last time I had to try and write a shape function in CSS that took me about 15 minutes to get it right, right? Like, there's just so many things that the language can do, and we are not using them because they're difficult to do in text. And again, OKLCH, like, logically, the whole community should have jumped on that right away. But I understand why they didn't, because now you have to mentally map to a new model with a color picker, right? That's not something you have to worry about. You can have the best of both worlds without having to reset your mind every time they make a change, right? So I think, like, go and explore these things because actually there's a ton of value there. And you might find that it's not the typing CSS that's the fun part of building websites. It's actually the creative aspect.
Thank you so much. Let us know down in the comments, what visual tools do you use in your daily work with CSS? What visual tools do you yearn for? And have you tried out Nordcraft yet? We've got all the visual tools you'll ever need. See you on the next video.